to church.
Welcome.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Good morning, church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome and good morning, and it's great to have you here. Welcome to church this morning. Welcome to the live stream of Willesborough Baptist Church, and wherever you're connecting in from this morning, we're just really pleased that you're able to be with us. We're here to worship God, to worship our King together, and we're a family, and we're so pleased that you are here with us. My name's Mark, this is Anwar. Anwar is the operations manager at the church here, newly appointed, and also chair of street pastors, which we'll be hearing about shortly. And of course, we've got Jackson here as well.
So a great good morning to each and everyone today. It's great to have you with us. And just a quick notice about the church. At the moment, obviously due to the lockdown, the church is closed, but is open to staff only at the moment. But we are making sure that we can still serve the community. So what we are going to do, if you have a need, please call the church Monday to Friday from 9 till 12:30. And we, as a church, will see how we can best support you through this lockdown period.
Yeah, we really want to support you. And also, you can get in touch with us this morning. The number is just above Anwar's head there, the text number. We'd love to hear from you, particularly if there's things that you want us to be praying for around communion this morning. Nothing that's too personal to you or to others, but, you know, maybe wider things in the world at this time. We'd love to be praying into those issues that God's laying on our hearts. And we are sharing communion this morning, so you're going to want to get some bread and some wine or whatever you have to hand that can help you to focus on Jesus' body and blood that was given for us on the cross as we remember that together. Also, we have whole church prayers this Thursday at 8 p.m. on Zoom. So look out for the notices on our Facebook page and do join in with that as well. But as I said, I wanted to ask Anwar a few questions, actually, especially as he's chair of Street Pastors. But actually, Anwar, you've been part of Street Pastors a long time. Maybe you could tell us a bit about that and what Street Pastors actually is for those that aren't familiar with it.
Sure. Well, I've been involved pretty much since the beginning, just over 16 years now as a street pastor. I've been a street pastor in London and now obviously moved to Kent, and is really working hard now locally in Ashford to support the work of street pastors here and do what we can to shine for our community. But it's a ministry that I'm overly passionate about. It is so important to me, and I really see God moving through this ministry. It's just been absolutely great.
Yeah, that's great. And what sort of things do you do as a street pastor?
What's involved? So we go out with this amazingly stylish uniform, and we go out normally in a team of four, and we go to the main, mainly the town centre, the station, and just places where we can meet people, talk to people, support people, try and stop incidents from happening, give out flip-flops to ladies who can't walk in their shoes no more, give out food to the homeless, and just be a general support to the community. We work very much in partnership with our local police and the council, and we just want to make Ashford a place where everyone can come and be safe and really enjoy their night out and just shine Jesus in our community at night time. And I believe our oldest street pastor is in their 80s, so it doesn't really matter how old you are. It's just having a heart for Jesus to be out there.
That's amazing. I'm sure Anwar will take sign-ups, anybody who's listening and thinks, I want to be a part of that. But just tell us briefly, what's it been like the last few months with lockdown and everything else? How's that worked?
It obviously has been a bit challenging, but where we can, we have been patrolling on a regular basis. We started off with prayer walking around the town, but also we have been doing live patrols. But since the latest lockdown, we've had to just keep to Zoom at the moment, but we are patrolling our streets through Zoom and making sure that we pray for every single street as we would patrol normally just at this time. But I'm sure we will be back out on the streets very soon so that we can, you know, continue to bless our community.
Great. And just before we go into worship, Anwar, just tell us, what are your hopes for the next 12 months? It doesn't have to be just in street passes, maybe in the church. What are you hoping for?
Well, obviously, last year was a bit of a tough year for so many. But this year, we just really want to shine for Jesus in all that we do, through street passes, through food bank, through the church, and all the churches in the community. We just want to share the love of Jesus in our community. And my hope for this year is that Jesus will be glorified in such an amazing way, and that people will be supported and loved through our Sovereign Lord this year. That's my main goal.
Amen. That's awesome. Yeah. Would you pray for us, Anwar, just as we come into worship this morning? That'd be great.
So, Sovereign Father, we just thank you for the opportunity of your church coming together this morning. Father God, we just pray that your presence will just go into every living room that is watching this live stream. Father God, we just commit this time into your loving hands and pray, Father, that, Lord, you would be glorified through this service. Lord Jesus, be glorified in every single way. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
This amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. No. amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down. You would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Dear Father, thank you that you sent Jesus. Thank you that he came here to redeem us through his death on that cross, through the grace that was shown and given, to the reconciliation that that brought. Words alone cannot describe what that means. May our lives reflect that sacrifice. See his love nailed on the cross.
Such love is this for me.
Say, Lord, come near. Lord, reveal yourself to me this morning. In our everyday lives, Lord, just reveal yourself to us. To run into those arms. You know, in the Bible it talks about a prodigal son whose father came running out to meet his son who'd been away for ages, who'd kind of said, I don't want anything to do with you any longer, father, and he'd run away and gone away, but the father ran out to him and spread his arms wide and said, come in, you have returned. Himself instructed us to have, as he instigated, as he started, as he founded this feast. He calls us to come near. Wherever we are, he calls us to come near and to feast with him.
Are you hurting, broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Yes, Jesus, we just thank you. You are calling. You're calling out across the world today, Lord, that we are those who've heard your call. We're those who've responded. And Lord, for those who are watching this morning, maybe they've not yet responded to your call, Jesus, we pray you'd speak this morning. Speak your words of grace and truth and love and forgiveness and reconciliation and peace and joy into the lives of all of those watching this morning. And we've just had a few texts through. Someone says, we are redeemed by the blood of Jesus, forgiven, accepted, and loved. We cannot earn our salvation. It's a free gift of God. We're no longer under condemnation. We live, for Christ now lives in us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah, the life that we now live in the body, we live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. What an amazing truth. I just pray those truths would sink into our lives today. And this says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. There's powerful words of blessing that are read out in so many churches. Often those words we speak when we are physically gathered together. And praise God for that grace and that fellowship we have in the Spirit, even when we are apart. And we've had some messages of things to pray for this morning as we come to the communion table. And we were thinking especially today of just the fact that when we come to the table and as we share the bread and the wine, we are hungering for the kingdom of God. We are hungering after the things of God. We are thirsty for God's justice and peace and righteousness and deliverance and salvation to come. And so it's right that we just pray and we intercede as God's people and we stand in the gap, as it were, for our world. And so, Lord Jesus, today, God, we pray for our world. Lord, we lift it to you in its brokenness and fragility and fallenness. And Lord, we thank you that you are making all things new. Jesus, we thank you that in Christ we are a new creation. And Lord, we thank you, God, that you have plans for restoration and renewal on a cosmic scale. And Lord, we pray for war-torn countries, Lord God. And we think especially of Yemen, Lord. And Lord, those children who are starving and malnourished. And God, our hearts break. And God, we pray, Lord, that you would bring provision. And Jesus, you are the bread of life. And Lord, we pray for physical nourishment and spiritual nourishment for people in these countries, Father God. And Lord, we pray for the United States, Lord. We pray that your peace would descend on that nation, Father God. Lord, we pray for reconciliation of Democrat and Republicans. We pray for unity of those in governance to act in accordance with the best, Lord, your best for the people of that nation and the world. And Lord God, we pray for truth and righteousness to reign, Lord Jesus. Lord, may your church rise up. May your church be purified. May your church stand up for you, Jesus. And Lord, as we think of our own nation, Lord, we pray this morning for our ambulance service, our call centers. Lord, we pray for call center staff to have the right words when speaking to scared and vulnerable people. We pray for ambulance waiting time to decrease. Lord, we've seen the pictures on our news of ambulances queuing up, Lord God. And Father, we pray for our health service. And Lord, we pray for protection for all emergency services on icy roads today. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, we're praying for all our frontline workers. And maybe right now you just want to lift up people who are on the front line, people who are serving, people who may be more at risk because they are seeking to care for others, care staff, social workers. And you might want to name people by name, lift them up by name in your home right now. I just encourage you to do that. Let's just pray. Let's pray for God to be with these people. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah, God, we thank you for the people who serve sacrificially, Lord God. We pray, we thank you for people who care for others. We thank you for people who protect others, Lord God. And Lord, we think especially of social care workers as well today as they seek to protect clients and vulnerable people, as they seek to intervene in situations of abuse, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you be with them. And your peace will be with them. And for those watching right now who are just so anxious about their work situation, God, bring them peace, Lord, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. And we're gonna sing a song And it just speaks about this longing and this hungering and thirsting for the kingdom of God to come. And as we come to the table this morning, I think it just reflects something of our prayers for this world and our prayers that the church will be revived and restored to bring hope and light, as Anwar was saying earlier, to shine the light of Jesus into this world. Sylvia messaged in this song, and she also messaged in the words of 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, then I will hear from heaven, and I will hear their prayer, I will heal their land. And Lord, we just call out to you today, Lord, that you would cause us to rise up and restore us and cause us to stand in the gap and pray and see your restoration and your healing poured out. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Have mercy, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. Restore us, Lord. Revive your church again. Let justice flow like rivers and righteousness like a never failing stream. Over the nations now, where is
Yes, Lord, our hearts echo those words, Lord, from your prophets. Lord, let justice flow like rivers. Let righteousness flow like a never-ending stream, Lord. And let it start in our lives as you restore and as you revive us. And as we come now to the table, Lord, we thank you for this bread and this wine, whatever we have, Lord. We bring it to you and we thank you, God, that you invite us to share at this table, to share in this feast, not because of anything we've done, but because of the finished, accomplished work of Jesus Christ on the cross and his resurrection. And the risen Lord Jesus invites us here today to share in this bread and in this wine. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to ask Anwar to read from Matthew 26.
And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body."
Yeah, so if you're at home, you can serve one another right now. And if you are on your own, let us serve you. This is the body of Jesus, which was given for you. Take this and eat it in remembrance of him.
Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
The blood of Jesus was given, was shed for us so that our sins can be forgiven. Hallelujah. And Lord, as we eat this meal now, Lord, and as we share it in our homes, Lord Jesus, we thank you that we share it with your church worldwide, your church universal, Lord God. We join with all of the saints, Lord God, all your holy people, and we hunger and we thirst for your coming kingdom, Lord, for that time when we will eat with you and feast with you and share with you in the fullness of God's kingdom when you come again and when justice and righteousness fill the earth. And Lord, we hunger for that kingdom now and say, "Your kingdom come, your will be done in our lives on earth as it is in heaven." Amen. Amen.
Sovereign Father, we thank you for the blessing of communion. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that your blood was shed for us on Calvary. Thank you, Lord, that you died because you loved us so much. But hallelujah, that you are raised from the dead and that you are alive forevermore. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Yeah, and before we open God's word together, and as we dive into Acts again, we're just going to sing this prayer, this song, "Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord."
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open up your word to us, that we may see something new, that we may be reminded of something old, that our souls can be refreshed, that we may live for you and for your glory. Pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, so say today we're going to be diving back into Acts. We left this series off just before Christmas, and we're going to be looking at chapter 9, and it contains one of the most significant and extraordinary conversions in the history of the church. It's a phenomenal passage, a well-known passage. And you know what? Those of us who believe in Jesus today, we have a testimony of our conversion, which is both infinitely precious and powerful. You know, we're not born into Christianity. No one is born a Christian. We don't become Christians through a series of tests, perhaps, or a particular accumulation of knowledge where we get to a point and suddenly that's it, we've passed the test. Or maybe by meeting some kind of prior standard, you know, by nationality or our family line or our culture. None of these things mean that we are a Christian. Even coming to church week in, week out, that doesn't make us a Christian. It's got nothing to do with anything that we've done. We become Christians actually because of what we've just celebrated, because of what Jesus has already done for us. You know, it's his death and resurrection that count. It's his work, not ours. It's his finished work on the cross where he took upon himself all of our sin. Yeah, everything that separates us from God and where he reconciled us to God. You know, as we sung earlier, this is amazing grace. This is the unearned, unmerited favor of God. You know, becoming a Christian isn't joining a religion. It's about becoming a child of God and receiving everlasting life. It's so much bigger. And so we become Christians because of what Christ has done for us. And we become Christians because Jesus meets us where we are. You know, we don't work our way up to God. You know, God comes down and we encounter him. He moves in our hearts. He reveals himself to us. He pursues us. And he keeps on pursuing us until that critical moment. You know, there is one thing we have to do, and that is we need to decide to leave our old life behind. You know, and we need to follow Jesus, to choose to follow him and receive new life. It is the most important decision you could ever make. And it's the best decision you could ever make to decide, this is it. I'm following him. I'm not turning back. You know, I've met with God. I've tasted and I've seen that God is good. I've sensed his moving in my heart. And now today, I'm going to follow him. And I'm going to follow his plan for my life. I'm going to trust him. I'm going to trust him more than I even trust myself or anybody else. You know, every day around the world, tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people decide to follow Jesus. And you know, it's a Sunday today, so it's going to be a bumper day, isn't it? You know, and there's no greater purpose than to live for God, than to serve the King of Kings. And there's no greater way to serve Jesus than to make him known. You know, as we think about conversion today, this is important. You know, John Piper says the most loving thing in the world that you can do is to pray and to witness and to live so as to persuade others to change the way they think and feel and live and become Christians. You know, putting your faith in Jesus involves changing the way you think. You know, there's this word, this kind of religious term or religious sounding term in the Bible that's used called repenting. Actually, it's not a religious term at all. It was used in the ancient world, this Greek term metanoia, to mean change your worldview, change your way of thinking, change your whole outlook on life, change the way you look at the world. And when we meet with Jesus, everything changes. Our perspective of everything else changes. Our perspective of our family, our perspective of those who've hurt us in the past changes because we forgive them. Our perspective of people who were our enemies changes because actually we're told to love them. You know, our perspective of those who are in need changes because we see in them the face of Jesus and we want to reach out and love them with the love that God has for them. And we start to look at people through God's eyes and we see that people are harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And we want to go and we want to share the love of God with them. You know, this is what the gospel calls us to do. And so I agree with John Piper 100%. Yes, it's the most loving thing that we could possibly do. Conversion is a crucial part of our faith, and it's an act of God's amazing grace. You know, that's why we hear these words, don't we? You know, sometimes in songs or in scripture, you know, or people speaking about coming to faith in Jesus, and they might say, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Or I was blind, but now I see. Or I was dead, but now I'm alive. Or I was in darkness, but now I live in his light. Or I was an enemy of God. You know, that's how I was living, even though maybe I didn't know it. But now I'm adopted into his family. I was far from God, so far, but now I've been brought near. And you know, in the middle of each of these statements stands the cross. In the middle of each of those statements stands the cross. Jesus is the way to the Father. You know, he's the way from lostness to foundness, from darkness to light, from death to life. It's Jesus. And it involves us acknowledging we need saving. You know, and thanking God there's a Savior. You know, Jesus, Paul says this, or words to this effect in Scripture in Galatians. You know, Jesus didn't die for nothing. You know, if you could attain righteousness with God through the things you do and through just living a quiet and good life, then what was the cross all about? You know, Jesus died for us because it was the only way that a sinner like me or a sinner like you could have life. A conversion has to take place. And heart transformation needs to occur. It might be dramatic and sudden, like the story we're going to read today, or it might be like a dimmer switch gradually coming on. You know, I said earlier, you'll have a testimony of your conversion, but you might not be able to pinpoint it down to a day and a time and a place. But you know for sure now that you follow Jesus and you're living your life for him. And maybe that happened over time. It might be like it's two steps forward and one step back, you know, with really many stumbles and falls along the way and turning away and turning back. It might be something that happened when you're very young, or it might happen at your very last breath. But there's no Christian without a conversion. You know, there's no Christian without an unreserved commitment to Christ. And it's all by God's grace. And so we're going to look at Saul's conversion today. Saul, who we might know as the Apostle Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, who planted churches across the nations and wrote much of our New Testament. But he had a really interesting backstory. So let's read in Acts 9, and we're going to pause to reflect along the way. So let's just read the first two verses to start with. It says, meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. You know, the way is referring to people who follow Jesus. And actually, just to recap, in Acts 8, which seems like a long time ago now, doesn't it? We've been reading about Philip's amazing ministry in Samaria, and then how he went and shared the gospel with and baptized the Ethiopian eunuch, and then was whisked away to Azotus. And that's where the meanwhile comes in. You know, while all of this is happening, while this ministry is going on. And all of this happens also in the midst of opposition to the kingdom of God advancing. So, you know, God's kingdom is advancing. We have these amazing people, the apostles. We have Stephen, and we have Philip, who are advancing the gospel. And then we read about this opposition that comes, and we read about Saul earlier on in this chapter. And this is the same Saul who approved and watched on at the stoning of Stephen in chapter 7. And in Acts 8, verse 3, it says this. It says that Saul began to destroy the church. He went from house to house. He dragged off both men and women, and he put them in prison. You know, in other words, he's waged war against the people of God. And he started this campaign of persecution. And when we are reacquainted with him at the beginning of Acts 9, he is still, we read, breathing out these murderous threats. In fact, he's so intent on stopping the church, get this, that he's pursuing some of the believers who fled to Damascus in light of this persecution that's come on the church in Jerusalem. And he's basically going to demand their extradition back to Jerusalem. And later in Acts 26, verse 11, we read that Paul says of his old life, he says he was so obsessed with persecuting Christians, he even hunted them down in foreign cities. He was that devoted to stamping out this new movement of Jesus followers that was threatening the fabric of the Judaism that Saul was part of. You know, in Saul's mind, this movement had to be stopped at all costs. It was subversive, and it was turning the world upside down. Paul often in his ministry relates to his testimony, which would have been well known across the early church and extraordinary. And in Galatians 1, we get a bit more of an insight into this mindset of Saul, you know, Saul as he once was. In verse 13, we read this in Galatians chapter 1. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I didn't go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went into Arabia, and later I returned to Damascus. You know, we're about to look in Acts 9 at this but God moment in Paul's story, the but when God. You know, I don't know if you have one of these moments in your life. You know, I know I have quite a few of them. And, you know, Paul tells us all about the religion of I, about self-importance and self-advancement and improvement. He says, I was a grade A student in the Jewish religion. I was a growing leader with much potential. I had growing influence. I had so many prospects, you know, and I was extremely zealous for the traditions of my father. You know, he had this zeal and this fervent passion for tradition and religion. And it was actually a dangerous thing. You know, misdirected zeal is always dangerous. I heard someone once say, you cannot be too zealous for love. You know, when you follow Jesus, you know, if you have zeal for Christ, then what it's going to lead to you is you're going to end up loving your enemies. You're going to end up forgiving people who've wronged you. You're going to end up laying down your life for the sake of others. That's what being zealous for Christ looks like. But actually, when our zeal is misdirected in other directions, it can be incredibly destructive and damaging. Paul believes, or Saul as he was, believed that he was serving God and advancing the cause of Judaism by destroying the church. You know, he was a religious extremist, a first century terrorist. And he goes along the road to Damascus in Acts 9, and he has his heart set on stopping the gospel in its tracks. You know, making sure the gospel doesn't get any further than Damascus. It's caused enough trouble as it is. You know, and this story, if you think about it, is the equivalent of a member of ISIS becoming a pastor because they meet Jesus. And you know what? There are actually stories of former members of IS who are now Christians in the Middle East, and they're advancing the gospel. And you know, I know that might offend some people, but that is how amazing the grace of our God is. And you know, and who knows how God will use those people in the future. This is amazing grace. Now, this is unfailing love. It's nothing. It doesn't depend on anything we've done. It's totally undeserved. And it's so much better than we could imagine, and so much better than some people can handle. But when God. So let's read on. Let's read this "but God" moment that happens in Acts 9, verse 3. As Paul neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, and he fell to the ground, and he heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but they didn't see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days, he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. Here is Saul, and we read he's advancing. He's probably advancing with an entourage, presumably of like-minded people on the same mission he was. Possibly there were some of the temple guard with him, and he's breathing out murderous threats. And then suddenly, and if there ever was a right use of the word suddenly, this surely has to be it. This is probably the biggest suddenly ever. Suddenly there's this phenomenal light, brighter than the sun itself, and it surrounds him, flashes around him, and this voice speaks. You know, what amazing grace that God meets us right where we are. God finds us. You know, we might feel like we discover him, but actually when we really look back, you know, if we reflect back afterwards, we realize he was coming to find us long before we were ever looking for him. You know, salvation's initiated by God. While we were still sinners, Romans says, Christ died for us. And so Saul, he falls flat on his face in this moment, unsurprisingly. And then he asks, I think a really good question actually. Who are you, Lord? You know, that might seem like a strange question at first. Surely, you know, Saul knows what's going on. You know, here's Saul, this highly religious, highly zealous person. But I think what's happening is he recognizes that this is a divine voice. You know, it is the Lord. But at the same time, for all of Saul's religiosity, he doesn't really have a clue who the Lord is. He certainly has no idea of what the Lord is like. And I don't think he knows at this point whether he is going to live or die. And I imagine he probably thinks he's going to die. You know, has God come to strike me down in judgment? Maybe he's come to reward me for the way that I'm persecuting the church. You know, so many people in this world, they have an awareness of God or a belief in God or maybe a vague notion of the divine, but they don't have really any idea of what God is like. And the glorious truth, as we say often, is God is so much better than any of us ever could even possibly have imagined. You know, conversion involves a realization, or at least the beginning of a realization of who God really is. It involves a revelation of God in Jesus that compels us to follow him and to give our lives to him. And at this moment, Saul is flat on his face and he is terrified and probably realizes that he doesn't really have a clue who the God he speaks of really is. And he's about to find out what God is really like. But he's going to get a glorious and wonderful surprise, because the voice responds and says, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting." Now, I think this is probably, if anything, has increased how terrified Saul is right now, because this is a scary moment. Jesus really is alive. You know, what these Christians are saying is true. No wonder they've been so bold. No wonder they're willing to lay down everything and risk everything for Jesus. and now what is this Jesus going to do to me? You know, in the light of all that I've been doing. But Jesus gives him a command. Now get up and go into the city and you will be told what you must do. I don't know where Paul is at this point in the story. Pretty shaken up, I'd guess. You know, glad to be alive, I'm certain. His conversion story isn't complete yet, I don't think. You know, he's blind. It says for 3 days he doesn't eat or drink anything, probably out of shock more than anything else. But we do learn at the same time he is praying. He is seeking God. He's seeking this Jesus who's just spoken to him. You know, he may be on the same physical route to Damascus, but his life has dramatically changed course. The inclinations, the motivations of his heart have totally changed in a moment. And, you know, perhaps he's struggling and he's in prayer and he's grappling with God to seek where do I go from here? What does life look like from here on? You know, how can I totally change? What is my life meant to be about, Lord? And then Ananias comes into the story. So let's pick things up in verse 10. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias, and the Lord called to him in a vision, Ananias. Yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he's seen a man named Ananias come and place hands on him to restore his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I've heard many reports about this man and all the harm he's done to your holy people in Jerusalem, and he's come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Just imagine being Ananias. You know, you've heard that Saul is on his way to Damascus and you know exactly why he's coming. And you and all the believers are surely concerned about this. You know, trusting in God, but at the same time, nervous at least. And then the Lord speaks to you and tells you, you're going to go to this very person who's coming to kill you, to Saul, and you're going to pray for him and you're going to restore his sight. If I was Ananias, I'd be thinking I'd actually prefer that he stays blind. You know, I didn't know he was blind, but this is good news because at least we'll be able to run away. But for the Lord then to say that this man of all people, this Saul who's been persecuting the church, is going to be God's chosen instrument to proclaim the gospel he's trying to stop, and to proclaim the name of Jesus, the name that he wants to wipe out to the Gentiles, you know, to all the nations. This is just unfathomable. You know, Ananias is going to pray for the one who wanted to kill him and who has probably already killed some of his brothers and sisters in Jerusalem. You know, this is very personal here. Ananias is told, however, that God has been working in Saul's life. And now Ananias has been invited to be part of that work. You know, Ananias is told Saul has been praying. He's seeking after Jesus. And, you know, never, ever doubt what God can do in someone's life. Never, ever write somebody off, you know, even if someone is your worst enemy, you know, because the surprising and amazing grace of God might be that that very person is someone who's going to give their lives to Jesus. Never, ever miss an opportunity to be part of what God is doing because you can't see or believe it. You know, I think so many Christians, you know, and I put myself in this category at times, we can just go from one week to the next, or maybe even one month to the next, totally oblivious to what God is doing in the lives of other people around us. And you know, it's sometimes like we don't believe that God is actually at work in other people's lives. But do you know what? We are called to be part of God's salvation plan for those people. This is amazing grace. You know, that Ananias here got to be part of this phenomenal work of God in the life of someone who was going to shape the early church. You know, isn't it amazing that God would invite Ananias and he'd invite me and you to be part of something amazing and life-changing and potentially world-changing? You know, I wonder if there were others who God had prompted before Ananias. You know, I wonder if he'd been trying to find somebody who would go and pray for Saul. I wonder how many no's he got before he got Ananias' yes. Now, verse 16 might seem a bit strange to us as well. You know, it might not sound all that loving. It might not sound all that like the Jesus who we know, because, you know, Jesus says, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Sounds quite ominous, doesn't it? Quite threatening. What do you mean, Jesus? But, you know, God is telling Ananias that while Saul has inflicted suffering on believers, he's now going to be the one to experience it for the sake of Jesus' name himself. But if we understand the New Testament, we realize this is actually no punishment. You know, in fact, repeatedly, this is a sign of favor and glory in the New Testament. Paul himself says, if you share, you know, we've come to be co-heirs with Christ. If we share in his sufferings, that we might share in his glory. You know, in fact, there is always a guarantee of reward for those who suffer for the name of Christ. And so even though there's still, don't get me wrong, there's still a severity in what Jesus is saying here. Suffering for the name of Jesus is never once used in a negative way in the New Testament. And it isn't here either. And it isn't a negative thing in our lives too. Verse 17 says this. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. And he got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. You know, amazing grace. You know, we can just imagine that song, can't we, by John Newton, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Yeah, Ananias, he goes to Straight Street. He follows what Jesus says. You know, Straight Street is still there in Damascus today. It's called Darb al-Muskatim. It's one of the main thoroughfares through the city. Damascus is one of the oldest cities in the world. And you know, so these events are rooted in history. And when he goes there, he says these two astonishing and beautiful words, Brother Saul. You know, actually, I think these two words should be enough to make us weep when we realize what Ananias is saying in this moment. You know, here is Saul, a man who's killed believers in Jerusalem and has come to kill Ananias and his friends, or at least arrest them ahead of potentially their death. And Ananias comes to him and he says, Brother, Brother Saul. You know, this is what Jesus has done. This is what Jesus does today. This kind of reconciliation is possible through Jesus. And, you know, it's happening all around the world. I'm reminded of the story of Jim Elliot and his wife, Elizabeth. They worked as missionaries in the 1950s amongst remote tribes in Ecuador. You might have heard their story. Well, in 1956, Jim, along with four other missionaries, they were speared to death trying to make contact with the Haroni tribe. And Jim left behind Elizabeth, and not only Elizabeth, also their 10-month-old daughter. However, his wife, Elizabeth, continued Jim's work. You know, she not only went back to that tribe, she reached out to them with the gospel, you know, this same tribe that had killed her husband. And not only that, she lived among them with her daughter. She learnt their language and she shared the gospel. Now, that's amazing grace. That is the kind of amazing grace that demonstrates who Jesus is and what God is like. You know, God loves those who are hostile towards him. He reaches out to those who set themselves up in opposition against him, and he calls us to do the same. And believers all around the world today, they risk their lives. They risk their lives on a daily basis to reach those who are hostile to the gospel and who could potentially even kill them for their faith. You know, often in Islamic nations, perhaps, where it's illegal to share your faith, this is happening because these people love their neighbor and they understand the grace of God. And that's what faith in Christ looks like. You know, it looks like what Ananias did here. Brother Saul, let me lay hands on you and pray for you. I don't know if you could imagine those who maybe done you significant harm in your life. Maybe you're blessed not to have people like that, but perhaps there are those who have sought to, you know, really, really damage you. Maybe they don't even realize the extent to which they've caused you harm. But the best thing you can do for those people is to pray for them, to pray that Jesus would reveal themselves to them, to pray that God would bless them, you know, to come in an opposite spirit to all that's been done to you and demonstrate that grace of Jesus in your life. Who knows what God might do? And Ananias, he gets to pray for Paul, not only to be healed, but to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And then he gets to baptize him. And you know what? You might not get to be a Paul in life. You know, let's face it, most of the people watching probably don't have a testimony like Paul's. And you may not get to travel the world planting churches, although hopefully there might be a couple of people listening who will do something like that. But you know what? We can all be like Ananias. We can all be obedient to what God tells us to do. We can all pray for others. We can pray for healing. We can pray for others to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and we should. You know, you don't need special training. Some people watching, you might want first prayer for yourselves to be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's amazing. But actually, we can all be used in this way, and we can all lead others to faith in Jesus Christ and be part of their journey to faith in Him. And we can even be involved in baptizing them. You know, normally this would be done amongst a family of believers. But, you know, my deep desire for all of us, really, in the next couple of years is that we get to be part of people's stories in the way that Ananias is here. You know, wouldn't it be awesome if part of the normal experience of disciples of Jesus in WBC and in churches across our nation is actually every now and then to be getting down into the baptistry with someone who we've been privileged to journey with to faith in Jesus. You know, wouldn't it be great if part of our everyday ministry was just to be praying for one another, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and praying for those who want to seek Jesus in their lives? Wouldn't it be amazing if we saw people healed? You know, actually, I have to say, it's astonishing the amount of answered prayer for healing over lockdown and over the past few months. Again and again, pretty much it seems like everything we're praying for healing, you know, God is answering those prayers, and we can't even be, you know, laying hands on people, but God is moving and working. And I'm just so excited to see this gift fan to flame in the church when we return. But just as we finish, it's worth us reading just a couple more verses in this story. Just look at this. It says, Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. What a turnaround. All those who heard him were astonished and asked, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among all those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? Yet Paul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. What a turnaround. What amazing grace. Paul advances the faith he tried to stop. He thought he was going to Damascus to destroy the church, but God had totally different plans. And actually, Saul ends up building it. And his conversion was so baffling, it says he proved Jesus was the Messiah. I don't know if you've ever asked someone, what would it take for them to believe in Jesus? It's a good question. And I think if you asked people at the time that these events took place, I could imagine some Jews jokingly saying, you know, if Saul of Tarsus becomes a Christian, then I will believe. And it happened. You know, many today still find the historic ramifications of Saul's conversion enough to convince them of the proof of the gospel. No wonder Paul appealed to his testimony so much through his ministry. You know, and I hope we can appeal to the things that God has done in our life when we share his love with others too. But as we close, I think it's worth noting that Jesus didn't save Paul in order to prove a point or to have a slam dunk proof for the gospel. Jesus saved Paul because he loved him and he had a plan for his life. And it was a plan so amazing it still touches lives today. And God's grace is deeper than all our sin. If he can save Saul, he can save anyone. His love is vaster than the universe. No person on earth is beyond the grace of God. And God wants to save people watching today too. He wants to save people from the consequences of sin. He wants to change our hearts and give us a new reason to live. He wants to fill us with his light and life and the power of his spirit and use you in his plans today because he loves you. Will you fall down before him today? Will you surrender your life to him? You know, I want us to pray. We're going to sing a song to close. The Zoom prayer room is going to be open from the end of our service. But right now, I just want us to just give a moment, an opportunity for people to respond to the gospel this morning. This amazing grace. You know, no one is beyond the grace of God. All are called to share in this new life. As we said, it's not about joining a religion. It's about becoming a child of God. And it's about having your eternal future changed. You know, it's about having eternal life with God and serving him all the days of your life here on earth. And if you want to take that step today and say, yeah, Jesus, I want you to come into my life, I just encourage you right now. You can call out to him. You can pray to him. You know, you don't have to say the right words. He knows your heart. Just say to him, Jesus, come into my heart. And, you know, I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray for us. And just as you respond, your Holy Spirit, I ask you to come and I ask you to fill us now. And Lord, sovereign Lord, I thank you that salvation is, it looks like the cross. It looks like the empty grave. You know, salvation looks like Jesus calling out and saying, Father, forgive these people who are mocking me and beating me and scorning me. They don't know what they're doing. Salvation looks like Jesus meeting with us and reaching out to us and saying, come and follow me. And right now, I pray that there will be people responding to that call and saying yes to Jesus right now. Lord, today we pray for the thousands of people who give their lives to you around the world. And God, we ask you be raising up a generation of people who will serve you wholeheartedly and will see your kingdom come here on earth. Lord, who will plant churches. Lord, who will be like Ananias and will love their enemies and will see you do astonishing things. And God, would you raise us up to know what you're doing in the lives of those around us? Would you raise us up to reach out to others and show them grace? And would you raise us up to lay hands on others and to baptize others? Lord, obviously a time when it's safe for us to do so. But God, we just pray that even now, you'd be working in our lives and our hearts and giving us astonishing opportunities to share your gospel with others. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, as I say, that Zoom prayer room is going to be open at the end of the service. I use this song as an opportunity to respond to God this morning. And if there's anything you want prayer for, that link is going to be in the description in the comments. And you can click on there and you can go there and pray with someone at the end of this song.
Yeah, maybe today you're like Paul. Maybe you've made that decision to accept that gift of forgiveness, that gift of grace. And if that's you today, then I want to congratulate you and welcome you into God's family. I want to say welcome, brother, welcome, sister. And if maybe you are like Ananias today, maybe you get the sense that God is saying to you, I want you to go and share the good news. I want you to go and say, Brother Saul, to somebody. And maybe that could be a person you'd never dream of saying that to. For whatever reason, but maybe God is saying that to you. Either way, that we want to pray for you and we want to know about those things that you're going through and you've decided to do. So please do text in or please do connect through to that Zoom prayer room where our prayer team will be so pleased to pray with you as you take these first steps in whatever way that is. I'm always reminded of a chap called Francis Chan, who gives a story about he was told by God to go and speak to a particular person. I think it was at a cafe that he was at, and Francis Chan looked at this person and thought, no, Lord, I can't possibly do that. This guy was a big biker. And Francis Chan was like, I can't go and speak to him. I can't. And actually, Francis walked out of the cafe and got into his car to drive off. But he just got that sense, that Holy Spirit just prodding him to say, no, go back in. And he went back in, and he nervously walked back up to this guy. And he just said to him, I don't know if this means anything to you. I don't know if this will change anything for you, but I just want you to know that God loves you. And the guy looked at him, and I'm afraid, sorry, there isn't a big miracle ending to this one. But he looked at him and said, it doesn't mean anything to me, but thank you. Thank you for telling me that. And maybe that conversation wasn't a big Paul conversion time, but actually that conversation mattered. And as we go out and do that, as we go out as new Christians into a world that will look different because of that change, or we go out in the name of Jesus to share his good news with people around us, we need to trust in him. We need to rely on his strength. We need to say, Holy Spirit, come and equip us and encourage us. You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. My eyes above the waves,
keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine.
Yes, Lord, we are yours. Lord, thank you that there's no better place to be than in your presence, than in your love. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for those who have decided to follow you this morning, or renewed that commitment to you, or Lord, decided that they will step out in faith to share your love with others. And God, thank you that when we step out, Lord, you never fail to meet us there in power by your Spirit. And give us the strength we need, and the words we need, and the courage and the boldness we need. And so, Lord, I just pray that anointing on your church this morning. Lord, your church across Ashford. Lord, your church across the UK and across this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, just a reminder, the Zoom prayer room is now open. So if you want to click on the description in the comments, please do click on the link. It'll take you through. There'll be someone who'll stand with you in prayer. If you're unfamiliar with this and you think, I've never done this before, essentially you'll be taken into a room with wonderful, friendly people who will pray with you in absolute confidence. And they will just listen to what you say. And you can say very, very little. You might just want to say, I just want prayer. Or maybe you want to be really specific with them. Either way is fine. But they will pray for you. And they'll stand with you and ask God to just fill you with whatever you need at this time.
And just a reminder that we would love you to join us this Thursday evening at 8 p.m. for our church prayer meeting on Zoom. The link was emailed out on Friday during the weekly newsletter, but we would love you to come and be with us this Thursday, 8 p.m. on Zoom, and we look forward to seeing you all there.
Yeah, definitely. And any other reminders of things that are coming up in church life, if you want to be up to date with things, then just connect with our Facebook page. You can like the page. You can send us an email if you want to be on our emailing list. You know, it's really important, isn't it, at this time, just to stay connected. And also you can subscribe probably down in that corner. You can click on subscribe if you're on YouTube right now, and that'll mean you'll know if video's coming up and when things go live. It's a really good way to connect in. But we're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for the things that God is doing in our lives together, and that he's been doing this morning. We long to hear more. So do text in if there's things God's been doing, as Ben says. Keep connected with us. And we pray that God would bless you this week, and that he'd go with you, and that you'd know as you step out in faith, his Spirit brings ample supply for all of your needs, and gives you his peace as you go out. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to church.
Welcome.
Welcome to church.
Church.
Welcome to church.
Good morning, church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome.
Welcome.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome.
Church.
Welcome to church.